Welcome to the Bible Momming Podcast, where we are parenting by the book. I'm your host, Paula Whidden. This podcast is for women who struggle with regular mom stuff, but also long to have their kids grow closer to Christ. It's a lifetime journey, and we're in it together. As a real mom, you just never know where I'll be podcasting from, but I'll always be available for you. Now let's get started. Hi, mamas. I am sitting here in my car on a rainy Southern California day, and I am excited to talk with you today. If you are on Facebook, I have started posting some short momming moment videos to encourage you. I know many of you feel frustrated because you don't have time to dig into God's Word throughout the week. I'm praying that these moments are a blessing to you. They're only a few minutes long, but I do pray they bless you. If you haven't yet subscribed to this podcast, click that plus button or check mark wherever you listen so that you can get each podcast as it comes out and you won't miss a thing. We love it when you leave reviews too. On your iPhone, just scroll to the bottom of the page and you can rate it and leave a review. This is so helpful. We all want to know that there's value when we take time to listen to a podcast, and your rating and review show other people the value you find in it. Now, today is a day to get practical, mamas. Did you know the Bible is loaded with references to food and meals? Some of the greatest stories of the Bible have food as a part of them. It all started in Genesis, of course, where in Genesis 1, it says, "Then God said, look, I've given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food." And then in Genesis 9, he later told them, "I've given you them," as in animals, "for food, just as I have given you grain and vegetables." Now, major events of the Bible happened with food. Jacob and Esau brought food to their father, each of them wanting the blessing. Joseph, without his amazing dream coat, helped the Egyptians to store grain so that people throughout Egypt and Canaan could have food during a coming famine, which also ended up saving his family. I don't know if you're familiar, but Passover, which happened in the book of Exodus, is a meal dedicated to demonstrating the community's trust in the one true God over all other little g gods. Then the books of Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy are loaded with special rules about food. There are some weird ones, I gotta tell you. The weirdest, for example, no eating bats or owls. That's found in Leviticus 11, 16, and 19. Honestly, that was never on my list of things I wanted to eat, but it was in there. Now, those were later changed in the book of Acts, as Peter was told that he could eat things that previously were thought to be unclean. Esther saved the Jewish people over a meal with King Xerxes. Daniel, as in the guy with the lion's den, ate only fruits and vegetables. Jesus fed 5,000 people with a few fish and loaves of bread. Jesus also had many memorable meals with his disciples, including the Last Supper, which we still celebrate on Sunday at our church with communions. Those are only a few examples. And needless to say, women prepared much of that food, as we do today. And so for some of us, that could be pretty crazy. I know it was for me, and I need to tell you a little bit about that. You see, I grew up as a fast food kid. And I learned how to cook as an adult. When I was young, my mom would head north or south from our house, and we would choose from the fast food places in the direction she went. So going south, we would have maybe Arby's or Taco Bell. Going north, we would have Burger King, McDonald's, I think, and I think there was a Dairy Queen. Now, as a mom, I wanted to be a bit healthier and, quite frankly, cheaper with my kids, but I didn't know how. I started with one recipe book before the internet was really a big thing. Yeah, that's how old I am. Shh. Now, I'm going to make sure that in the show notes, I share with you some really good recipe books, but I'm also going to give you some links, so hold on. Now, when my girls were born, I wanted to feed them good stuff, and I had this book about feeding natural foods and what food you could feed when, because I know that babies can only handle certain foods at certain times. For example, no honey in the first year, because they can be susceptible to things that are in the honey that aren't a problem after the first year. Ironically, as I looked at it and I saw some of the choices they had, they said Avocado and sweet potato were great things, not necessarily together, by the way. They were great things for babies to have as first foods. I had not really eaten that much avocado or sweet potatoes. So I felt really weird giving my baby something I had never eaten myself. So I tried them. And guess what? I liked them. Now, this started improving my own food choices. Isn't it funny how kids help us be better? Of course, over time, we were challenged by some of the things that each of the girls liked or didn't like. One of them would not eat meat at all. When I discovered she would only eat dino nuggets at a certain point, which I didn't like because they had a lot of sugar and I wanted to avoid that for them, I went ahead and I fed it to her anyway. Mamas, I know some of us are going, but if you give her sugar when she's young, her taste buds are going to form around that, and she's going to be eating sugar with meat all of her life. Apparently, that's not how it works, because that same girl, not that passionate about sugar nowadays. Now, one of my daughters loved bananas when she was young, and then suddenly she stopped and hated them. One of them was, I could feed her just about anything, anything. And the other one wouldn't eat most anything. Now, meanwhile, I had heard that there were benefits to eating together as a family at the table instead of watching something on TV, which is what I grew up doing. And I thought it sounded cool. I mean, I wanted it. That's not what I had, so I thought it'd be great to try that. But as many of you know, that is tough with toddlers. As soon as they are out of that chair, they don't always want to sit down for a meal. It's kind of like trying to train a wild animal in some ways. Now, don't get me wrong. I adored my little wild animals. But moms, we're in a marathon thing. We are working on a lifetime journey, right? And they are not always going to do things the way we want them to. So my husband and I have learned that we needed to model what we wanted to see. Eventually, they started joining us because first, we insisted. We also turned off the TV, made everything away from the table boring, and brought games to the table. We would play different games at the table while eating a meal, which was great for me because I didn't know how to do table conversations, but I did know how to play a game with somebody. Honestly, I wasn't a big board game person when I was younger, but I really wanted that time with my family, so started working on it. There were some of our games that we brought to the table that were great successes, and some were complete flops. Again, this is a lifelong journey, and I'm here to tell you that to this day, my husband will sometimes stop off at Goodwill on his way home, just looking to see if he can find an interesting game for us to play that will be cheap, because if we don't like it, he doesn't feel like he invested that much in it. On our show notes, I am going to make sure to give you a list of some great games so that you have some options and things you can do with your family based on the age of your family. Now, if this is something you struggle with or just don't understand, I feel your pain. There's a group called the Family Dinner Project, which is a nonprofit organization that operates at Harvard University. And they made a list of the benefits of family dinners based on research. It's a shortened, simplified list. They said some of the benefits of family dinners are better academic performance, higher self-esteem, a greater sense of resilience, a lower risk of substance abuse, lower risk of teen pregnancy, lower risk of depression, lower likelihood of developing eating disorders, and lower rates of obesity. And research also suggests that when a family gets together, they feel a strong bond with one another when they eat together. Everyone leads these disconnected lives at work and school, and this time allows them to reconnect. And that is why I believe that it's not necessarily just a family dinner. I think it depends on what works for your family, because our schedules are so all over the place, right? So one of the things that I've learned is if your family meal needs to be breakfast, make it breakfast. If it needs to be lunch, make it lunch. If it needs to be dinner, make it dinner. But if you want some of that magic mojo in your home, let me pass on some of the things I've learned, because I had to start from ground one and I want to help you out here. As a mom, I wanted to do family dinners, but I didn't really know how. And here's what I've learned. Keep trying. If your husband isn't fully on board, share the benefits with him. Try maybe one or two or three dinners a week away from the screens. And I mean away, as in none at the table. You know, you're looking each other in the eyes. You're talking to each other, right? It's a social space. And at our table, those gizmos aren't allowed when we're doing family time at the table. Here are some tricks, though. You need to learn how to ask the good questions. And the good questions don't require a yes-no answer. It takes practice. So asking everybody at the table, you know, including yourself maybe, what was the best thing about your day? What was the high of the day? What was the worst thing about your day? Asking them, is there something you wish we would know about your day that we haven't asked? Kids love sharing this stuff. And honestly, our husbands love sharing it too. So it becomes great because they want to share with you. Now, I'll be honest, because you're making the effort, sometimes they might not realize that they need to ask you too. Don't worry about it. Just volunteer and start telling them, okay, and so my day was, okay? Eventually they'll catch on and they will ask. If you don't have time to cook, find a great restaurant that you all enjoy, or either go there or bring it home and eat at the table. The togetherness is the goal. It's not about the matching plates. And I know some moms who don't like to cook, and the dads don't like to cook. And there are some great cooks out there who have either made the boxed meals or have restaurants that you enjoy. And if you have the finances for it, go for it. I have spoken with families that also struggle with food aversions, severe allergies. It's tough. Our girls didn't have those issues. We had plenty of opinions, but it's a little bit different. It's tough when you put your energy into a meal and the last thing you want to hear is that it was horrible from a three-year-old. It messes with your confidence much more than we want to admit. For me, I had to decide to make things that my kids like, but I also like, and make only the things that I also liked, except for special occasions. That way, if they complained, or when they complained, I would just think, okay, more for me. And it helped me to be more content as a mom. When they were little, we did have some tense times, but I discovered that if you stick to it and you don't give snacks before meals, they actually were hungry. For us, that worked. But I know people who try that, and because they have very strong-willed kids, it doesn't work for them. So you have to keep trying, keep experimenting, and figuring out what works for your family. I know a mom who uses a triple crock pot to please everyone at once, and that gives her sanity. It's supposed to be a bonding time, not an I'm losing my mind time. So whatever works for you. Now, if this is new for you and you're just struggling, I want to tell you some of our best meals were taco night. You can have everything separate, all the parts separate, and then just let the kids add what they want to their own taco because they're going to have to eat it. And what you need to do is make sure they watch you add what you add to your taco, because on their own, I'm telling you this happens. On their own, they will be curious about what mom and dad eat, and they will check it out. If it's not for them, it's not for them. You could try make your own pizza night where you give assorted toppings for the kids and they can put their own stuff on the pizza. And for those of you who are gluten-free, I've heard some good stuff about the cauliflower pizza crusts. I know that some places have. But you make your own pizza, and they feel like they have choices because you've given these options to them, and so they don't complain as much about what was just made. I had to learn how to make some homemade chicken nuggets because I didn't want to have all that sugar eventually. Mac and cheese, we started off with the box, and we progressed to homemade mac and cheese, which involved real cheese, not powder. But no judgment here, ladies. If you're with the box and that is your friend right now, it's not going to be the healthiest thing for your body, but sitting down as a family with box meal is just as good as sitting down with a family with the real cheese meal, okay? Some people like pasta night, and that can be a diverse, you know, you can do all sorts of stuff with pasta. There's gluten-free pastas, there's rice pastas, quinoa pastas, regular traditional pastas. You can add meat, you can add beef or chicken or, you know, whatever you want, lamb. You can change up sauces. You could have a white sauce. You could have a tomato sauce. You can switch it up and you can have them off on the side and it could be make your own. You know, if you have the sauces separate, let them stir in what they want in their thing. I've also learned that you can keep bringing things back that at first they didn't like. Now, I know we all have the stories of the thing we didn't like and our family tried to push on us. So here's the catch. You don't force it except for one thing. We developed a 3-bite rule. Now, for those of you with kids with food aversions that are like major psychological things, this might not work for you. But for the rest of us, 1 bite does not change the taste buds, but 3 can. So in our house, everyone was expected to eat at least 3 bites of any meal. There were times when I was consoling myself, of course, with the extra food that I realized at least I liked. But what also surprised me is that over time, some of the things they hated in the beginning, they actually requested, and now they love them. For example, butternut squash soup. So this is a weird one for me, it was. I never ate any squash except pumpkin pie before my babies were born. And then I heard a butternut squash soup, and I was getting silly about it with my daughter. It was just us home alone. I made up a song about butternut squash soup. An absolutely stupid song. I don't remember it, but it was, I remember us dancing around being silly with about butternut squash soup because, quite frankly, I was making fun of it. And then I went to a restaurant with my husband and I saw it on the menu. And I thought, hey, you know, for fun, I want to order that. So I did. And I liked it. So then I started seeking out recipes and testing it on my family. It helps that my husband is not a complainer. And guess what? Now they love it. I also learned to involve kids in the process and they'll eat more. My picky eater started giving me her opinions as I cooked. Actually, I invited them. I remember I was making tuna fish, and she wouldn't eat tuna fish. So I decided to say, okay, could you help me out with this? I wonder, should I add something crunchy to this or should I keep it all smooth and soft? And she goes, I think crunchy should be in there. And I said, okay, should it be celery or jicama? And she decided jicama would be better because we would have sticks of jicama sometimes. And so I chopped up some jicama and put it in the tuna fish. And she was thrilled that I listened to her. And guess what? She ate the tuna fish. Now, I invited her to help with shredding lettuce and eventually taught her other cooking skills. And guess what? She's no longer a picky eater. Now, don't get me wrong. I made sure my other child learned those things too, but I just want you to know that was stunning to me. I didn't know that was an option. So I'm here to tell you, mamas, that's an option. You can find ways to expand their taste buds, especially when they see you try new things. If your local grocery store has unusual fruits, try a new fruit of the week. And be honest. If it's sour, say it's sour and you don't like it. You know, but let them test it too. Sometimes they want to see if they like something you don't like. Sometimes they just want the challenge, right? As you do this, you'll find that the time you have cooking together, talking about it, sitting together at a table, playing a game, building lifelong family connections, all this time is amazing. I know it takes effort. I know it's exhausting, especially when you do so many other things. But if it's got that big of a payoff, and if it's that big a part of the Bible, it's something we should check it out. We should try these things together. The less we're together, the less we'll be together later on in life. Because if they don't spend that much time with us when they're kids, why would they want to when they're adults? Don't give up, mamas. You can do this. Now, I'm going to make sure that the show notes, as I mentioned, for this podcast include some links to great recipes, board games you can try out with your family. So be sure to go to BibleMomming.com. And click for the podcast for episode 25 so that you can get those links. Now, for mamas with babies, I'm going to give you some links to healthy food ideas. And I'm not that big on extra additives going into my baby. So if that's your story, go out and check the show links over at BibleMomming.com. Mamas, you can do this. Don't let mealtime be a mania for you all the time. I've enjoyed this time we have together. I know you have plenty of things to do and many options. So thank you for listening. Remember, love is patient, love is kind, and that is never more real than in our families. God bless you and have a great week.